Friedl Frederica Dicker was born on July 30, 1898, in Vienna, Austria, into a poor Jewish family. Her father was a shop assistant, and her mother passed away shortly after she was born in 1902. Not much is known about her early childhood, despite the major trauma of losing her mother, which she eventually compensated for by dedicating her life to teaching hundreds of young children. Friedl's artistic career began with early experiences in street puppet theater and a short course in photography in 1915. Soon after, she joined the textile department of the Vienna School of Art and Crafts, where she attended drawing classes that encouraged free creativity and exploration of the students' inner world. In 1916, she joined Johannes Eaton's private school, where she learned to separately break down formal elements within her art, such as rhythm, texture, composition, and tonal values, while also learning how to compile them back together again within her work. Friedl later embraced these early drawing exercises when she began teaching her own students. In 1919, Friedl went to Weimar, Germany with Eaton, where she studied with Walter Gropius, the founder of the Bauhaus, until 1923. The progressive art of the Bauhaus movement promoted Friedl's own inner development as an artist and her relationship to art, while enlightening her to issues of social justice, economic and moral crisis, and ideas on how to build a better world. The Bauhaus encouraged Friedl's ideas regarding a utopian form of communism. It is after studying with famous artists like Paul Klee within a profound movement that impacted the history of art, Friedl established the Workshops of Fine Art in Berlin with a fellow artist from Eaton's private school, Franz Singer. Together, they began working on textile works such as stage and costume designs, book covers, and toys for children. Friedl returned to Vienna in 1925, where she began creating pieces that fit with the Bauhaus idea of combining architecture, sculpture, design, and fine arts into a unification of one expression. A year later, Friedl and Singer established the Atelier Singer Dicker, designing toys to stimulate the intellectual abilities of children as well as other utilitarian fine art objects. During this time in Vienna, her educational career in teaching launched after being invited to teach a course on art to kindergarten teachers. However, in 1934, Friedl was imprisoned in Vienna after being arrested for communist activities, forcing her to move to Prague after her release, where she married her cousin, Paul Brandius, receiving Czech citizenship. It is during the next decade that Friedl began to develop into a more serious painter, transitioning from constructivism to figurative art. It is also during this time she began to work more seriously with children who were political refugees from Germany, applying the earlier techniques she had learned from Eaton and the artists within the Bauhaus. She soon discovered how she was capable of forming an intense bond and relationship with children. However, Friedl's life was dramatically changed in late autumn of 1942 after receiving deportation orders by the Germans occupying Prague.
When a new child comes, everything seems strange to him. What? On the ground I have to lie? Eat black potatoes? No, not I. I've got to stay? It's dirty here. The floor? Why look, it's dirt, I fear. And I'm supposed to sleep on it? I'll get all dirty. Hear the sound of shouting, cries, and oh, so many flies. Everyone knows flies carry disease. Oh, something bit me. Wasn't that a bed bug? Here in Terezin, life is hell. And when will I go home again? I can't tell. Teddy, L,
410-1943.
Hitler, as the world would be told, built a city for notable musicians, writers, artists, and leaders to protect them from the stresses of war. His real purpose for Terezin was to keep the creative elsewhere in an effort to suppress uprisings or objections from reaching the so-called civilized world. 200,000 women and children would pass through, Of the 15,000 children that were entered and deported, only 232 were known to have survived. At the height of the war, the ghetto Terezin held over 55,000 Jews. The camp was made to support just 5,000. The Little Fortress, a building that used to be a former prison, was used to house troubled citizens of the ghetto. It was here that Jewish artists were sent when caught stealing paper and other supplies, in which they produced writings that recorded daily life. But it was their work that allowed the outside world to know dramatically about the life in Terezin. This was not a death camp by the usual definition. This was a holding station where men, women, and children would be starved and worked. Often they built boxes and coffins or separated the clothing of already executed Jews. Once they could no longer physically contribute, they were taken to Auschwitz, where they surrendered their own clothing their peers would later sort through.
In concentration camps, writing and drawing was prohibited, but the arts found a way to flourish. Musicians, artists, actors, writers wrote and created masterpieces on scraps of paper, discarded materials, and whatever art supplies they could sneak into the camp. Friedl brought with her as many art supplies as she could. She devoted her time and energy to teaching art to the children held in this horrific concentration camp. Friedl was able to bring comfort to the children in this tragic environment. She offered the young a chance to communicate and express their fears and their defiance and create hope. The arts provided children a momentary escape from their harsh realities they faced. The children drew their concealed inner worlds and their tortured emotions. This gave Friedl the ability to enter and try to heal. In October 1944, Friedl packed up some 5,000 artworks created by the children in two suitcases and hid them. Her and her 30 students were transported to Auschwitz, where they were killed upon arrival. The two suitcases remained undiscovered for the next 10 years. Hidden in those two suitcases were art, poetry, and music. The artwork is a witness to the horror of the Holocaust. But more importantly, they are a tribute to the human spirit. Friedl had amazing courage. Her actions gave children hope in their bleak reality. A little garden, fragrant and full of roses. The path is narrow, and a little boy walks along it. A little boy, a sweet boy, like that growing blossom. When the blossoms come to bloom, the little boy will be no more. She's commonly left out of art therapy books, but Friedl was the mentor to the well-known art therapist Edith Kramer. Edith Kramer knew of her teacher's imprisonment and death, and it influenced her future outlook on the cathartic power of the artistic expression. In Kramer's Art as Therapy book, she wrote, quote, "Dicker's name is not well known in the U.S. I feel, though, that art therapists ought to know something about this woman, her ideas, and her fate." Even though Dicker and most of the children were murdered at Auschwitz, their art, as well as a few of the lectures Dicker gave at Terezin about teaching art to children, survived, testifying to the sustaining and healing power of the art. End quote. Friedl is one of the overlooked, the unknown, but she deserves to be honored, to be recognized. So we say thank you, Frieda Dicker. Thank you.